am Lucy from Arts at the Heart, and I was really hoping to meet you face to face today, but it hasn't worked out. So I decided I will use the time that I would normally be with you to make a little video and show you as best I can some of the things that you wanted to learn. You saw the photos that I took of little things I've been trying to experiment with, just play around with, using unwanted plastic to try and put it to better use. So I thought I could start with something pretty simple. I hope something that people of all ages can try. Maybe children might need a little bit of help with the hot things because I'll be using a glue gun, and I've got an iron handy for the heat fusing. But actually, with guidance at first, is something that children absolutely love to be able to do, and if you just teach them how to do it safely, you can get glue guns that are lower temperature, and with your iron, it doesn't have to be on the hottest setting. You can also iron on a lower surface, so they're not wobbling around on a high up ironing board, or you can lower your ironing board right down, maybe take the cover off so it's nice and hard. Anyway, I'm getting into details. But yes, so I have actually given away the three little bowls that you saw on the photo, but I made this one the other day just to show you that you can use any kind of mould. Here's the mould I used for this one. It's just a glass, and you start upside down, and then you can just trim it to the top of the bowl or the glass that you're using. I'm not exactly sure how many bags I used for this little tumbler, but I can show you how to start, and I can show you the process, and I can skip ahead and I can show bits I've made earlier, Blue Peter style, so you don't have to wait for me to do all the braiding. And let's just see how we do. Okay, so I collect my bags in here. So what I'm doing is just flattening out the bags, because you'll see it's quite interesting to sort of understand the structure of a plastic bag as well, I always think. So I'm flattening them out, trying to sort of unfold, especially the handles get quite crumpled up, so unfolding them and flattening them out. This is the first process. Don't know if my computer has gone off now. What's it doing? It's still filming? Yes, great. Okay, so I love the colour of the Red Mart bags, I have to admit. So, bit of a guilty pleasure. They look great with the red Hawker Market bags if you end up with some of those as well. But even just this with the white or the transparent works pretty well. Okay, I'm going to stop there because you get the idea with that. If you want, you can pause the video while you flatten out a few more bags. But I will go on to show you what you do next. So, if you're making plarn, which you can then make a big ball of to knit or crochet with, then you will need to do this stage as well. So the first thing you need to do is cut off the seam. Let me just make sure that this is being filmed properly. Yeah, so you cut off the little seam at the bottom. And I'll show you how to reuse this part later. And you cut off the handles. If you're making plarn for, if you want a long continuous piece for knitting or crocheting, then the next stage will be different. But I'm going to show you a super, super simple braiding process today. With braiding, you can attach your pieces as you go along, which is, I think, quite cool, because you can almost immediately get started and you don't have to be patient about creating your enormous ball of plarn, which is obviously, plarn is plastic yarn. Such a cool word. Okay, so maybe I'll just finish off this fourth one. I and you can be doing this at the same time, or you can fast forward me to just learn it all and then go off and do it independently. I was hoping that we could be a little group of chatting, learning, sharing ideas, you know, craftivists. But that will have to happen another time. Okay, so I've got my four bags like this. So the next thing you want to do for braiding purposes is to cut them into loops. And obviously this is a loop. So if you want, you can flatten it all out. And you could, if you wanted, just cut a strip. But if you want a shortcut, you can leave it folded like this, for example, which already has a fold. You can fold it again, similar width, and again, and even again, as many times as you want, but that's quite a comfortable amount to cut. And you're wanting strips that are about the same width as this, actually. So strips that are a bit like this. If you just do one little snip like that, then you have a loop. Okay, so you need to do lots of those. And I'm the kind of person who doesn't correctly follow recipes or measure very much at all. So, and that's just the way I am. I have accepted it now. I'm not going to start measuring at this late stage in life. So some of these are slightly different widths, but in my experience, it really doesn't matter. It all comes out in the wash. Okay, so you're going to end up with lots of these. I won't bother doing all of them. But the idea is basically each one of these loops is going to be a strand to braid with. So you can already, I'm going to show you already how. You're going to take three, because you need three for braiding. You're going to tie a little knot on the end, just to anchor them. Now, I used to always make my friendship bracelets growing up, or little braids or whatever, out of embroidery thread, for example. I used to always attach it to my toe and sit cross-legged. I don't know if I'll inflict that upon you today. But what you can do sometimes is use a safety pin, which I happen to have here. So maybe I'll do that, see if this works, because I've got something I can attach it to here. More sensible. Okay, yes, I might just move this actually. See if you can see. Yeah, okay. So all you do is start braiding. So you find your three separate loops. Okay. If anybody can't remember how to braid, it's really, really simple. You've got your three strands. You take your right hand one over into the between the other two, and then you take your left hand one and take it over into between the other two. So it's right into the middle, left into the middle, right into the middle, etc., etc. If this was a super pro YouTube video, it would be sped up here and you wouldn't see my hands, it would just be a blur. But it won't take me very long to just get to the end of these and show you how to link up with another piece. This is exactly the kind of repetitive, easy technique that lends itself extremely well to just putting the world to rights, having a chat with some lovely people. Okay, so when you get towards the end, to keep waking up the computer, otherwise I feel like it's gone off. You simply use one of these loops, take a fresh one, put it through, and then take your long part and put it through your little loop. And that will connect them. So I'll do that. I'd like to show you actually is how I've got a little strand that's different. Oh yes, look, I'll add a lovely red one. So you'll see that the loops are different lengths. Yeah? So if I add a red one to another piece, then eventually you'll end up with strands that are knotted at different intervals, which is a good thing, because if I'd carried on just using the red mark bags, the green ones, I would have consistently had to knot again at exactly the same spot. And here I will, because I've used three red mark bags to start. But if I took... that might be a complete one, I know. If I take now three different bags, then I'll have three different spots for the next knots, which is quite a nice situation to be in, because then the knots each time get kind of... that's not a full one. The knots get kind of hidden away in a nice way. I'll have to make another one. Anyway, let's just carry on here. I'll do another red mark one here. And at least we've got one red one to show you. Actually, that's funny, isn't it? Very confusing for anyone who doesn't shop at Redmart. Redmart should have red bags, shouldn't it? It's got these lovely green washi bags, which talk all about being oxo biodegradable, which wouldn't ever happen in Singapore because everything is incinerated before being put into landfill. Okay, so here we've got to a sort of lumpy bit with three knots. So this is the kind of thing that I like to avoid if possible, because it will work out better for your project if the braiding is quite nice and consistent. So now, because I want to keep on camera, I'm going to just take the pin out. And I could either move it further along the anchor, I could just pin it here and anchor it, or I can just tie it around because I've got a little bit of a loop. Can I show you? Yeah, I've got a little bit of a loop here, so I'm just going to tie it around. Okay, let's make sure that you can still see. Okay, so that. Braiding. I'm just going to go to the end of the first bag. It should be the red one since it's a slightly smaller bag and the loop is shorter. Oh, I love those colors. So therapeutic, I love braiding. Breathe. Calm down. And chill. Okay, so then, as you can see, it would be time for me to attach another bag here, so I'd have a little tiny knot that would get sort of hidden away in the braid, and later on I'd attach another one there, another one there. Okay, so that is the end of that little stage. I am now going to switch over to one that I have, a nice long one. I have been known to carry these around in a big ball that I add to on the bus, or in a taxi or something. It can be annoying for people because it's a bit of a rustly sound, though, so I've had to stop a couple of times because of that. Anyway, so I already have this nice long braid. So now I can show you how to create a bowl. So for the ones that I showed you in the photos, I used a bowl like this. I used this actual bowl, actually. What is great to be able to find is one with a nice flat base, because I don't have an example here, but you know a lot of Chinese bowls, or bowls in general, have a little sort of foot to them. If you try to use that as a mould, I think there's a danger you won't get it off again. You need to think about the shape. It needs to be able to lift easily on and off your mould. So this I found works beautifully, because if you just make a small bowl, it's nice and shallow. You can imagine putting jewellery or little, safety pins or something in it. So that's what I used last time. I've done one like this to show you as well. They're quite robust. Waterproof, obviously. You could also use that for toothbrushes. But this is one, this is just a glass bowl that I'm going to use today. It's got a tiny little foot, but it doesn't go out again, so it's going to be very easy to take the bowl off. So what I'm going to do first is actually wrap it up in a... I like using the clear or the white plastic bags, because especially if they're clear or if they're just thin and white, you still get the effect of the colour on the inside. But I want you to be as creative as you desire. Use your own ideas, and I'd love to see what you end up making. So this is how I make sure that it is sort of a... in my studio, on my own for the first time in a while, I feel like things are unsticking on the walls. I'm not quite sure. What? Is there a gecko in there? I don't know. Anyway, so yes, I wrap the bowl up in a piece of plastic, and sometimes I tie it tightly so that it doesn't slip around. And then that ends up being the inner lining of the creation. So you can either find a sort of natural, a corner or something, but I've found that I did do that once or twice, but then I found that actually it's not necessary. It's better to just find a nice clear bit. So here, for example, a nice clear bit. Try tying a knot here. Russell. Okay, so that is nicely secured. A little bit of air in it, you can press that out. Okay, I'm going to just put it upside down. Right, next, I need to heat up my glue gun. And that should be it. Okay, now I'm not thrilled about the glue gun process. So if anybody has a better idea, or if anybody knows of any ecological glue, I would be thrilled to discover how I can improve this process. But at the moment, the best solution I've found is the glue gun, because you need it to be sticking as you make it. So you can't use a glue that takes a long time to dry. It has to dry almost instantly. You could use super glue, I guess, but that could also be a nightmare. If you get a little bit of glue on your hot glue on your fingers, it can be hot, but generally it cools down so quickly, and that's why it sticks fast, because it cools down fast, and as soon as it's not hot, it's not sticky anymore. So it does work really well. Okay, so here's my pre-prepared braided plastic. I think you could leave the knot on the end, but I'm thinking I might just snip it off. And this looks like it's getting nice and hot, but I want to try and catch the drip. I've got anything. And I just, here's this old bag. Now, the hot plastic is, the hot glue, I mean, is hot, obviously. So it will sometimes make a hole in the plastic if you put too much on. But normally, what I've found is that with a little bit, just a tiny touch, it can melt through the braid, and that's no problem. What you don't want it to do is melt through the inner lining if you want it to stay completely waterproof. But also, most people are probably going to use them for decorative purposes, so it's not a big deal. Okay, so you can see that the glue is sort of emerging, so it's melted. So the first thing you need to do is secure. Let me just make sure that this is visible. Yeah. So we'll just secure the braid in the middle of the base. Approximately in the middle, don't stress. Don't need to get your set square protractor out or whatever. Okay. And then, just as I'm sure you have guessed, you need to make little coils. So you might want to do a little bit of glue around the side and quickly place it on. You want to coil quite tightly so there's no gap between. The pieces. I think this would be the part in the YouTube video that's sped up again. Maybe it will. Who knows? Maybe I'll do something fancy with this video and get all sort of vloggy with it. I doubt it though. Okay. So before too long, you end up with a nice little base. And you'll see that there are little threads of hot glue that kind of collect, but don't worry about those. Just leave them and you can tidy it up at the end. Some of you might be wondering, if you're not doing this, if you're actually just watching me and getting slightly distracted, you might be wondering about the background in my studio. So you can see that way is a kind of wall hanging I made that used to be in my painting clay studio. Painting clay is this non-judgmental, multi-age painting in a safe space that I facilitate. And I call it No Comment in Singapore. But it's inspired by Arno Stern, who is this incredible 97-year-old French and German dude who I trained with in Paris. And when you create one of the studios for the painting, you start off by covering up the walls with craft paper, and so the studio is just got these sort of natural light brown beige walls at first, but then over time, through the process of painting clay, they end up looking like this. And that's just like the trace behind of all the lovely people who have come to paint in my studio. That's the base done. I'm already working up the sides, and I've already hit some groovy red. Can you see? This bowl is slightly trickier than the ceramic one I showed you earlier, which was lovely and smooth. But it's fine. This is fine. So I hold it on, press it on a little bit, just sort of insist a little bit, make sure it stays where I put it. And with the glue, it doesn't have to be perfectly underneath each strand of the braid. It's just a little dot here or there is fine as well. I do try to minimize my use of glue. Because it's either more plastic or it's something from an animal. Which is not my favorite thing to do with animals. gonna go fast forward now. But you'll just have to sit here patiently with me. We would have been doing this all together. Maybe we are. Maybe you are. I hope you are. Now, not sure how much braided plastic I've got. It's got lost somewhere underneath my skirt. How much I've got left and how big this bowl is going to end up being. But if I want it, right. Ah, I think I might just finish off this one actually. I might just keep going and make a nice big one. So I haven't really calculated how long it takes me from start to finish on a project. It would be amazing if you could factor in the time for actually finding the thrown away plastic, washing it. Like, I don't know if any of you know an amazing Gambian lady called Izatu Sise. There's a lovely children's storybook called One Plastic Bag that was inspired by her. And she, many years ago now actually, quite a while ago, started collecting all these plastic bags that were just floating around everywhere in the Gambia being dumped, and realized that they could be repurposed in so many ways. And she's now trained thousands of women to collect and clean and, you know, process, just like I was showing you, sort of cutting them, you know, flattening them, cutting them into loops, and then making proper plastic yarn. So not braiding, but a long spool of yarn that they then crochet with, and they make these amazing, gorgeous crocheted bags that, you know, super useful and pretty, that they sell to make a living. But these amazing women, I think she's got 20,000 women now trained in the Gambia, making a living for their families, empowering these women. Oh, they knew how to do, from the horse's mouth, one of the women I saw in a video about Izatu said that all she could do before was cook. And now she can do all these other things, including another amazing thing they do is they, I think one of the main sources of trade in Gambia is groundnuts, and they generally don't send the groundnuts with their shells, and the shells are just waste that gradually decomposes and creates the greenhouse gases. But they have repurposed the groundnut shells to create these little fuel blocks for people to use for their fires instead of actually going out and cutting down trees. And they're, of course, because they're super clever and resourceful, they are replanting forests that had been... I thought something like that was going to happen. They've been replanting forests. So they're just an amazing bunch of very hardworking, innovative, community-spirited women. You inspire me greatly. So you should check Izatu, I-S-A-T-O-U, Izatu. Yeah, Sisay, C-E-E-S-A-Y, Izatu Sisay, check her. And the bag, the book that is a really lovely book that kids like, you can see on YouTube being read out with lovely music in the back, African music in the background, is called One Plastic Bag. And I've used it to teach at the International School of Geneva. And I realised when I was doing summer camp with Dulwich College Singapore that they use it, I think, in year 3 or 4 for a cool project. Units of inquiry, maybe, as well. Nearly finished. Only got this to go. if you didn't want to put a lining in, you just wanted the effect of the braiding on the inside and the outside, you could do this without the lining. I've seen people do that before, but I added the lining idea just because I suppose I'm an artist, but I'm also a designer, and I really love beautiful and functional things. So adding a liner makes it much more functional. You're not going to get leaking. And it's going to be much easier to clean if you do use it for anything that gets messy. Right, so that is one. That's about as much as I'm going to get out of that glue stick. I think I had started it before, so it wasn't a full glue stick, but I reckon you probably would use that amount of glue per bowl. So that's my one thing that is bothering me, and I want to come up with a better idea. So please, put your thinking caps on. Okay, nearly there. This is weird. I've used this studio for so many painting clay sessions, but normally we're pushing against the paper for painting on. This time I'm just sitting here with a bit of air conditioning on. Nobody's painting. And the paper has decided to start falling off one of the walls. Oh, no. Might end up completely covered. Whoa, it's on its way. No! Oh well. All part of the fun. Little adventure. At No Comment, Singapore. Okay, last little bit. And then, I mean, if I wanted, I could easily braid a little bit more and I could get right to the top of that bowl, but I think I might just stop there. I'm going to unplug my glue gun. And then, let me unwrap this. This to show you, or maybe I'll just turn. Okay, so this is what it looks like inside. Oh, I think this is one of my favorites. I love this. Okay, and then you'll want to trim around the top of the bowl. You need to sort of get rid of this bit. Decide how you want to do that. You could angle it, you could stick it down with inside, that could be quite nice. And like do an extra little dot of hot glue, so I'll turn it on again. We're using in a minute. And I want to reuse this plastic, obviously. So I'm gonna try and do it in an economical way. Come in from the closest spot to the edge. Trimming the lining. Okay, this I will use later. Now, decide on the, is this going to be a design feature? I love to turn anything a little bit problematic or unexpected or mistakes. I love to somehow turn them into beautiful oopsies. I'm just wondering about Beautiful Oops is a Barney Salzberg book, by the way. And it's one of my favorite books. It's given to me by my dear, dear friend, Claire, who I used to teach with, and who also worked together in Geneva, and now she's in Singapore. She's often inspiring me. But Claire gave me Beautiful Oops by Barney Salzberg years and years and years ago. And I've read it to practically every class I've taught, whether I've taught them art or anything, because it's such a great book for celebrating imperfection and human diversity and uniqueness and all its glory, and just, for me anyway, that's how I use it. And it fits into all the growth mindset stuff that we do so often in school these days. It's just so important. It's about encountering mistakes and somehow turning them into something wonderful, often more wonderful than you'd even planned in the first place. Right, so I've done a little bit of an extra braid. And could be a handle. Oh, that is so sweet. Yes, it's going to be a handle. Okay. So, a little bit of hot glue. Sometimes it's nice also to make it obvious that it's something handmade, that it's something made from waste. Waste management is just such an interesting issue. I'm such a fan of recycling, and I'm so interested in the amount of waste that we create as humans. Of course, I'm really interested in just reducing it or eliminating it. But if it can't be reduced or eliminated yet, then let's repurpose it into something beautiful or useful. Okay, that's a tiny little bit of extra securing. And then we've got this cute little handle. I like that. Wow. So thank you for sitting with me through that. So I said I would show you also how I make gift wrap and how I repurpose the scraps. It's really not hard. It's the way I made this wall hanging over here. And it's really fun. So let me put that to the side, and also take the table away because we need a bit of a bigger space. Okay. And bring over a little piece of paper just to protect on the floor, just in case, because it's... Let me see if I can angle this as well. Yeah. You will definitely need greaseproof paper also, for whatever surface you're using, because the greaseproof paper allows you to iron plastic without it sticking to your iron. Very important. So now we have iron time. That's a loop. Okay, so we're looking at the scraps, just the scraps. So when I made the wall hanging behind me, I was just starting to experiment with plastic and heat fusing and things. And I was using practically whole plastic bags, even the handles, sometimes as part of the... I should probably show you that. I will take photos and add them or something. I was using handles at the top to hang them from the stick. Now that I'm making quite a lot of plarn and stuff, which doesn't require the handles, I have to find a use for the handles and the little seams at the bottom. So this is something that I have been doing. I've been making sheets of fused plastic, just using an iron, some greaseproof paper, a hard surface, and experimenting with nice combinations of colours. to make. It's a material, basically. It's a you could use for anything, and I want your ideas again. Let's brainstorm this. Can you? Just let me see if you can still see this. Yeah, okay, let me here. Love to get a little bit of red in this. Just give it a bit more red. Oh, no red. Oh well. I've got a popular bag here. Naughty. I'm yet to get my family completely trained, I must say. It takes a while. I forget sometimes. Or I change my handbag and I end up without a cloth bag in my bag sometimes. It's so frustrating, but it's just, we're human, we're fallible. So I could use that for making loops. That's not red though, I could use this bit maybe. It's just nice to get a splash of another colour in. Some white. This is red. Okay, I don't want to do too much more of this, and you'll get bored. So, the good thing about when you fuse plastic is it will normally adhere to the other pieces. Not always, but normally. And the interesting or challenging thing is that it will also shrink the plastic. So, it will shrink it more or less depending on, I guess, the chemical makeup. And that can end up making it quite bumpy, lumpy, and you just have to go with it. You just have to make the most you can of the situation, go with the flow. So you want to have them overlapping. Let's try something like this. So that they can attach to each other. And I quite like to mix in bits. I mean, it will help to give it some strength. You could do something like this, but you're just playing again. It's like my painting playing with colour on the paper. This is just playing with lovely, colourful bits of plastic. To think that this could have been incinerated, or just could have just been blocking a drain. Somewhere, because there's so much just floating around in Singapore. It really, really upsets me. I don't understand it. And I know it's not just Singapore, and in some ways Singapore is way better than other places. Oh look, I've done something silly. Laid it out on my normal paper instead of on my grease proof. So let me see if I can slide this under. It may not work. Okay. So that's good. I made a very important intentional error there. Not intentional. But very good for you guys that I did make that error. Because now if you've also made that error, you will remember it and you won't do it again. So get your surface ready with greaseproof paper first and then lay out your design. Then, just like a scrap plastic sandwich, take your lovely greaseproof bread, put the layer on top to make your yummy sandwich, and then you've got your iron set to non-steam. I'd say medium temperature, so I set it for approximately silk temperature. If you set it to acrylic, obviously, acrylic is plastic. When you're wearing acrylic clothes, you're wearing plastic. And if you're ironing your acrylic clothes, you're trying not to melt them. You're just trying to flatten them, not melt them. So it needs to be hotter than that, because we are trying to melt the plastic somewhat. And we're fusing it together by melting it. So I would put it up to about silk. It doesn't need to be as hot as cotton. And I've emptied the water out just in case I forgot to turn it off steam, because you don't need the water. I actually don't think it would make much difference, because with your greaseproof paper, that's going to create a kind of barrier to the water, but you don't need it. So we might as well save water. Okay, so let's see what happens when we iron this. You can see there's a little bit of color on my greaseproof paper from other times I've used it, because sometimes the ink from the plastic does come off. Right, so this is the fun thing is, I'm ironing it now. I'm gonna take the paper off and you'll see that it might still continue to do some weird things, like undulate and...
You can see some of it is fused. Move that there.
Okay. It's really nicely fused here. Some of it hasn't stuck so much, so you could, I could turn it over and try on the other side. Adding a bit more heat. So I could turn my iron up a fraction. Maybe I'll do that. Nice. I'm gonna do one more time on this side. It's definitely an experimental process each time. I need a bit more heat. So now I've got it between 2 and 3. So I've got 3 settings on my iron, and it's between 2 and 3. So it feels quite strong, quite substantial. There's a little gap here. I'm gonna patch it up. Remembering to put my greaseproof paper on again. Patched up. Great, so I have a sheet of paper, or not paper, a sheet of plastic that I could use for all sorts of different things. I wonder if I can, I'm just wondering, can I do origami with it? That would be really interesting. So I obviously want to explore this material a lot more, but one of the most obvious things you can do is wrap up a little gift for someone. And of course, you can, instead of using tape or glue, you can cut a strip of this stuffy sheet that you've made to make a little ribbon. Let's see, you can trim it to be a bit neater. But again, I quite like letting people see how something is made. I think partly sometimes it's a bit like a circus performer almost falling, like a tightrope walker teetering and almost falling. It shows you just how difficult it is, how much practice, how much work has had to go into being at that level that makes it look easy most of the time, but then every now and then they let you see a little chink in the armor.
Can you see this?
Yeah. And oh, this is so sweet. I think it's also really nice to create art that can be a conversation piece. So if you give a gift to somebody that's handmade or upcycled or repurposed, how sweet is that? And you're doing it because you've got strong principles or beliefs or values, then it's not shoving them down someone's throat at all, because you've just taken the time to create something with love and care, something beautiful. And you don't have to say a word, but if they're interested, then they'll ask, and then they'll see
that it's possible.
That's sweet. So there we go, there's that. I also wanted to show you how you can create something that's a little bit more structured. So again, you can make something that is maybe even more reusable. And I recently sent my dad a special pen for his birthday. And I made a little pouch for it, and it was just the simplest of things. I can do that again here. So then you would want to say I wanted to make a pouch for this. Let's see. Okay. So you can tailor it to the gift that you're giving. I'm just going to straighten this up a little bit inside. And I actually got my sewing machine out, and I sewed a tiny little detail on this for my dad.
Well, this is not filming very well, is it? No, that's better.
But you can heat fuse quite a lot of it. So what I could do is something like this. Okay, so then I'll take it out. And I will attempt to, using my greaseproof paper again, and just fold it over. You can see through the greaseproof paper, which is really handy. So I can just fuse an edge. Yay! And make a little pocket. And then what I did for my dad was I took some sort of ribbon parts. And how did I do it again? Oh yeah, I sewed it. Sewed a little cross, a little kiss on the back. And it was a long enough ribbon to be able to come around here and tie. So I could, I'm not going to bring my sewing machine in here right now, but I could easily do that. So a nice plastic ribbon onto the back here with a little kiss or whatever you wanted. And then it's just loose and you bring it round and tie it here. In a little bow, whatever you want. But as I have said many times already, I think that you guys will come up with some even more gorgeous ideas. And I can't wait to share them with you. So I'm going to say bye-bye now, because that it. Not bad, 54 minutes, and we were supposed to be meeting for an hour, but I was hoping that we would chat lots and you'd give me lots of, we'd just share lots of ideas. So probably would have run over time. But anyway, here you are. I hope this was useful and interesting for you, and I hope that we will meet and pick up rubbish together, or just hang out, be craftivists together. Sometime soon. Take care. Stay safe. Bye.